But what is needed that I will talk a little later. After in 2017, we are spending, if you look at the public spending on education, we are spending 4.13% of the GDP on education, according to the latest figures. 4.13%, of which 1.84% is spent on elementary education, 1.03% is spent on secondary education, and 1.26% of the GDP is spent on higher education. And if you split the general higher education and the technical higher education, then we are spending 0.68% on technical education, technical higher education, and 0.58% on general higher education. So this is what we are spending on education. And the size, we have 15.5 lakh teachers supporting the higher education. And as I said, that we have 993 degree awarding institutions, 37,645 colleges, and 37 million students who are enrolled. When you combine the students in face-to-face plus ODL mode. So the argument is that higher education is not necessarily the one of the arguments. I mean, you have arguments both in favor and against it. I was delivering a lecture in the Saturday Club of India International Center, and Gurcharan Das, you must be reading him, he writes a lot in the newspapers, and he's a very learned man, and he said that he countered me actually. He said, you are saying that you are spending 4.13%, but we are spending much more than that. I said, how? And then he said that you are not counting the resources which are invested by the private service providers and by the parents. You are simply, I said, you look at the recommendation made by Kothari Commission. He categorically mentioned that public funding, India should aim at spending 6% of the GDP. Public funding. I'm not talking about combining that. The argument coming from such kind of people is what? The argument is that higher education should not be completely funded by the state. Because higher education is highly restricted and highly usually restricted and highly skewed in favor of the children coming from the well-off families. They say that if you critically analyze the enrollment in higher education, you would find that more number of children are coming from well-off families. So you are subsidizing the education of the children coming from the well-off families. And it is hurting, and not the children coming from the disadvantaged sections. So this is one argument, I mean, coming from one quarter. And therefore, we should not do that. Now, but despite, and they also say that higher education is not a public good. It depends upon the individual's perception. How do you look at it? Okay? They say that it benefits the individual. But if it benefits the individual and that individual contributes to the growth and development of the nation, then it cannot be treated as a commodity actually. It still remains a public good. Now, the now, what should we do actually? The campuses are not making enough noise to impress upon the state governments and the central government to provide greater resources. This is one of the problems actually. You make me the vice chancellor?
Mm-hmm.
I will be worried only about my 5-year term. वो निकल जाए मेरा किसी तरीके से. We do not do that. The second problem is that Finance Commission does not make sectoral allocations. This is one of the serious issues actually, which I raised it a number of times, that why should it not make sectoral allocations? I mean, what is it? Who prevents us to create another budget head to provide sectoral allocation and education? In education, we are spending only 14% of the total budget. And now we are saying that, and 4.13% of the GDP. I mean, these are two different indicators. One tells you how much, what percentage of the total budget we are spending on education. As a nation state, we are spending only 14% of the total budget. In terms of GDP, we are spending 4.13%. Now, we need greater support. And that greater support should come in a variety of ways. One of the ways could be the subsidies. People start raising such questions in the corridors of power that a student will spend, मुझे तो नहीं पता कोक की बोतल कितने की आती है, but that is the very often cited example in Shastri Bhavan, कि कोक की बोतल पे पैसा इतना खर्च कर देंगे, फीस नहीं देंगे. And they will say that in your central university Hyderabad, you are charging only 285 rupees per semester. Per semester, 285 rupees, which is one of our good universities, research intensive universities like Jawaharlal Nehru University. And when you raise the tuition fee, I mean, no vice chancellor dares increase the tuition fee. That is the problem. Uski phir kursi hil jati. That's the problem. I think you have to look at it from a different angle. As I had said earlier, that in all developing economies, education happens to be a public, is treated as a public good. And it is the responsibility of the nation state actually to empower children. And empowerment can come only through education, because education is the only means of empowering human beings, humans. And since state does not have adequate resources to support education of about, we have close to 40 crore children in the age group from 5 to 23. 19.5 crore children are in the elementary sector, 6 to 14. And 6.5 crore children in the age group 14 to 18, and then around 6 or 7 crore children in the age group of 11 crore children in the age group of 18 to 23, if you take that block, which we use for computing the gross enrollment ratio. Now, if you look at how much money are we spending per capita expenditure, you will be surprised to know that we are spending only 5,315 odd rupees in elementary education. Only 500 rupees more, 5,800 something on per capita expenditure in secondary education, and 15,400 something per capita expenditure in higher education. This is what we are spending. Now, how can you expect a quality education? And one is the subsidies actually. Then we also make drastic distinction between the private institutions and public institutions, which is not made in the United States of America. And then we start comparing ourselves with the Harvard and Stanford and Yale with the United States of America. In US, a private university can access as much resources as a public university from the federal government in terms of research grants. In fact, universities are run on the shoulders of the faculty members. Here, the private institutions will not get the research support, barring I think DBT and TST. UGC will not give a penny to the private institutions, as if they are not shouldering any responsibility of the government. So one is the subsidies. The another one is the fee waivers. The second way of supporting the higher education group could be through fee waivers. Then the grants. Then the loans. We started providing loans, but the conditions are so ridiculous actually that that scheme has not taken off. Then we also have two very serious problems in our sector. One is the underutilization of resources because of the poor planning and because of the poor vision of the leaders, many the educational institutions. And we also have equally serious problem of misutilization of resources. We suffer from both actually, misutilization of resources and underutilization of resources. These two problems are. And another thing is that we do not have proper governance system, and there is no autonomy at all. We have been talking about autonomy for a very long time, and it is an internationally acclaimed reality that you cannot achieve excellence without the autonomy. Autonomy and excellence have to go hand in hand. But autonomy doesn't mean, autonomy is a self-regulating exercise with fullest amount of commitment and accountability. Fullest amount of commitment and accountability. Autonomy doesn't mean that you provide money to the university and vice chancellor should have a free hand to use it the way he or she wishes to use it. Autonomy has got a deeper meaning actually. And there are three things I would like to say in brief about autonomy. Seeking autonomy, retaining autonomy, and furthering autonomy are three dimensions of autonomy. If you want me to reflect upon it, I can reflect, but it will take a little longer actually. It requires a separate lecture on autonomy. But I would like to, I repeat that. Seeking autonomy, all of us seek that. Retaining that autonomy and furthering that autonomy. These are three different concepts insofar as autonomy is concerned. But we want autonomy without preparing ourselves for retaining and furthering that autonomy. The real autonomy on the campus of an academic institution is, I will not make any distinction amongst my students on the basis of caste, color, gender, creed, religion. I may be having my own ideology, but my ideology will not get reflected when I am teaching in my class. Autonomy also requires, on the part of the teacher should come down to the level of individual learner, regardless of his or her background, and make sure that everyone learns. And I'd like to give one example, which I experienced after my master's degree when I went to the United States actually. My professor, I went on Fulbright Fellowship there, and my professor asked me, he advised me to sign his program actually. He said that it will cost you only $330 and you will get a diploma during your fellowship. So why don't you do that? I did that. I signed it. I went to the class and I will not dramatize it more. There was my One of my peers was from Holland, actually, Eric Wallström. He was sitting in the front row. I was sitting in the middle because that was my first exposure to the Western world. The usual tendency, I was driven by that usual tendency. So I was sitting in the middle of the class. He was sitting in the front row with Nika and a can of Coke in his hand, which was very, unusual for me. And the professor, he was explaining a concept actually which involved seminal steps. And after he was through with those seminal steps, he asked us whether we had understood that concept or not. So he said, "Have you got it?" I have never forgotten that experience. And this Eric Polstra was the first person who raised his hand like this. Like we used to do it in our primary classes when we would mark our attendance. So he said, "Yes, Eric, tell me." He said, the name of professor was William Mahans. And I did not know that Williams in America at that point, I did not know they were called Bills. So he was called Bill. So he said, "Bill, what the hell you have taught? Nothing has got into my head." And you know the first impression I got? That iske to $330 gaye. He is finished. And then Professor Mahans said that, "Fine, Eric, can you tell me specifically what have you not understood?" He said, "I have not understood anything. It went over my head." He said, "All right, and I'll try again." Second time he explained, and I could analyze it later actually, not at that moment. His language was altogether different, and the examples which he cited were also very different actually. He was very slow, and after his second attempt he asked, "Eric, have you got it?" And Eric said, "Yeah, the first four steps now make some sense to me, but not the last three one." I could not see any change on the face of Professor Williams actually. And he said, "All right, let me explain the last three steps as well." He again explained it. And he said, "Eric, have you got it?" He said, "Yeah, now Bill, it makes some sense to me. Now, this is what is required and this is what really means autonomy, which we never ever deliberate upon in our classrooms. We do not encourage questioning actually. We do not prepare our children like that. If somebody raises hands twice, oh my God, you can very well imagine the fate of that person. So the point which I was trying to highlight was the value and the meaning of autonomy, which we keep crying actually, that we want autonomy, but we cannot achieve excellence without autonomy. Universities are driven through executive orders all the time. And the teachers and the vice chancellors are doing everything but teaching and research. This is what is happening. You have to prepare the video and then post it on the portal. Well, should it be the job of the university? What are we demonstrating for actually? So this is a very serious problem. Now, whatever little money do we have actually, where shall we put our money? I'm coming to that point now. Where shall we put our money with a view to bringing about qualitative improvement in education? I think what we need to do is that we should put our money on curriculum designing. How many universities have the curriculum with futuristic orientation? Why only in Stanford those university, University of California at Berkeley, they are in close proximity. Why are they having the curricular provisions for designing roads motorable by driverless car? Why are they doing that? Why other universities are not thinking about it? United States of America does not have that kind of an infrastructure as of today, but universities are busy. So the point is that the curriculum, we must invest on curriculum designing so that our curricular provisions have futuristic orientation. We should visualize that what is going to be the shape of the society, shape of the world, shape of the country in 10 years from hence. It may happen, it will never happen 100%. But you would certainly be preparing for that. Then the curriculum transaction. We will invest. We would like, I would ask Jurel that you put up the national flag on top of your building, okay, and spend 1.5 crore on that. But I would not ask him to focus on curriculum, on classroom processes. We are not investing money on classroom processes actually, which will improve the quality. The quality will improve only through classroom processes actually. We do not care for that. We must spend on that. We must spend on oral communication actually. Why are we churning out tongue-tied children? And then we are saying that their background is like that. What do you mean by the background actually? They have come to you to overcome the inadequacy which they have in terms of language proficiency. So it is our responsibility to see to it that everyone speaks, everyone is able to articulate, and articulate in a very systematic manner, in a very methodical manner. The another thing is about the assessment methods actually. Assessment, we are not coming up with innovative ways of assessing the potential of individual learner. Same paper and pencil test, attempt any 5 questions out of 10. Professor C.V. Raman, who was a Tamil, but he became C.V. Raman in the city of Calcutta. And he was only an accountant in the patent office. He was not a professor. And when he was taken as a professor in the university, he used to design his question paper and he would say, because he has to swim with the current to some extent, so he would also say, attempt any 5 questions out of the given 10, or he would qualify, or attempt question number 7. Why have you not learnt anything from Professor C.V. Raman? Why would he design that kind of the question paper actually? So we must spend on innovating the assessment tools which can help us measure the real potential of the individual learner. We are never talking about benchmarking of learning outcomes. Benchmarking, we are awarding degrees. We will give distinction, we will give first degree, first division, second division and third division. But until this day, we cannot cite it specifically that after 4-year undergraduate program in engineering or after 3-year undergraduate program in exact sciences, my student will be able to know A, B, C, D, will be able to understand E, F, G, and would be able to perform X, Y, Z. So why are we not able to do that when the child stays with us for nine long months and we are interacting with him every day? I think we must spend on benchmark, subject specific benchmarking of the learning outcomes. The another about the continued professional development. See, if we have to remain relevant in our own domain of specialization, I think we should invest on continuous professional development. I am happy that this kind of a program has come up wherein you have got the opportunity to be together here and learn from each other. So this is what I would like to say. about insofar as financing is concerned. I will close here. I also have data and facts and figures about funding, but I will not like to spend more time on it in a theoretical manner. If you have questions, I would appreciate and I would like to answer to your questions before I take up the second part of my lecture, wherein I am going to focus on the issues and implications of the new National Education Policy 2019. So, questions please. Sir.
Mr. Vedh Prakash, I have been an attentive listener to the whole discourse and have also heard you earlier.
Sir.
And I find that there is a sort of enlightenment in everything that you say. You were talking about how we need to invest in higher education. You talked about several things, but I think that one thing was missing,
yeah.
And that was methodology. Right? You couldn't talk about it. Shouldn't we invest in methodology also? And I think that that is the greatest problem. Prevailing teaching phenomenon.
Prevailing?
The teacher has got the material, the teacher has got the access to the man, that is the teacher, but he is not aware, the teacher is not aware of the methodology that he has to make use of.
Didn't I talk about that when I was talking about classroom processes? I was talking about classroom processes, I meant that only actually.
Okay.
That is very important. You have very rightly raised this issue. It's very, very critical actually. Methodology. See, methodology is so much important actually. You should invent the methodology from the point of view of the slowest learner in your class. Only then it will, see, in a class, you have different kinds of learners.
Since an example you have given was for that.
You have innovative learners. Innovative learners have different likings and dislikings. Okay. You also have analytical learners. They would have different likings and dislikings. You also have common sense learners. They would require different kind of, they have different likings and dislikings, and you also have dynamic learners. So, unfortunately, we are not trained for those kinds of things. We never categorize our students as innovative learners, dynamic learners, analytic learners, common sense learners. We will deliver the lecture and then go up. Whether only four of them, some of them are certainly going to pick up what you have taught, because in a heterogeneous class you have a very mixed group. So pedagogical processes are of paramount significance, and in fact I am one of the devotees of this. I said university, you have three sectors. One is the elementary sector, another is secondary sector, and the third one is the post-secondary sector, which is our sector. Unfortunately, in our country, these three sectors are working in isolation. They think as if they have got nothing to do with the higher education things, they have got nothing to do with the secondary sector things, they have got nothing to do with the elementary sector. And teachers also keep shifting the responsibility. They would say, "Isko kuch aata hi nahi." Bhai, aapka kaam to wahi hai. Now, who is the big brother? You are the big brother. And I had submitted a proposal that all institutions of higher learning should be given the responsibility that they should organize orientation programs for the school teachers during the summer vacations. They are more enlightened people, isn't it? You can't expect that kind of an enlightenment from an elementary school teacher or from a secondary school teacher. You are more enlightened and you are better placed. You want to be the best person to let them know that if you have to teach this concept, break it into the following parts. Use the following examples. And these days, ICT, information and communication technology, makes it very easy actually. See, when you would say then, when the electrons are revolving in different orbits, when do they release energy? I mean, if you see the conversation which took place between Pauli and between Rutherford and between Neil Bohr, at that time it was very difficult to, you would only conceptualize it, but you would not be able to see it. Today, through technology, you can see the dropping of the electron from the higher orbit to the lower orbit, and then you can explain it. So this ought to be conveyed to the teachers teaching in the lower classes, and it should be our, why Indian Institute of Science Bangalore is such a prestigious